In 1941, the war of machines was already raging, not in the skies nor on the seas, but across invisible waves of radio and mathematics. Hidden inside the Reich's high command was a new kind of weapon, a cipher so complex that even its creators believed it unbreakable. They called it Lorenz, a teleprinter cipher built for Hitler's most secret messages, orders sent across occupied Europe. The Germans believed no enemy could touch it. They trusted the superiority of their minds, not machines. But across the channel, in unassuming huts and silent rooms, another idea was forming. By 1941, the German High Command faced a modern dilemma. Armies spanned continents. Divisions moved faster than messengers could travel. The war's brain needed a nervous system, fast, secure, untouchable. At the communications firm C. Lorenz AG, engineers developed a secret attachment for teleprinters, the Schlüsselzusatzgerät, or cipher add-on. To its operators, it was just another machine. To historians, it became the Lorenz SZ-42. Each message began as plain German text. The machine converted it into electrical pulses, 5-bit letters, Baudot code, and merged it with a stream of pseudo-random pulses generated by 12 rotating wheels. Every wheel had a different number of positions, some prime to the others, so their combined pattern would not repeat for billions of characters. The result? A cipher mathematically beyond human reach. Inside Hitler's headquarters, Lorenz units linked field marshals from Paris to Königsberg. Commands flashed through the air unseen, disguised as static. To the Reich, it was an electronic fortress, and in its arrogance, a sign of supremacy. But even fortresses crumble if one brick is set wrong. Across the channel, British ears were already listening. In huts filled with receivers, members of the Auxiliary Territorial Service recorded strange bursts of tone from the air. The cryptographers at Bletchley Park nicknamed the German teleprinter Traffic Fish. Each stream of gibberish corresponded to a distinct German network, and one of them, codenamed Tunny, was the voice of Hitler's high command. Operators intercepted thousands of 5-bit characters daily, but to human eyes, the Lorenz cipher looked like chaos, strings of meaningless letters, unbreakable without the key. Then, in August 1941, chance intervened. A German operator, pressed for time, resent a long message with the same settings, a fatal violation of cryptographic procedure. Two identical key streams, two versions of the same text, and in that repetition, a pattern. The opening through which mathematics could pry. From those two flawed transmissions, British codebreakers reconstructed the skeleton of Lorenz's secret wheels. One man would take it further than anyone thought possible. William Thomas Tutte was 20-something, quiet and brilliant. Before the war, he studied graph theory, patterns, links, networks. At Bletchley, those abstract shapes became the logic of survival. Without ever seeing a Lorenz machine, Tutte deduced its architecture purely from intercepted messages. 12 wheels divided into 3 groups, Qi, Psi, and Motor. Each group advanced differently. Qi wheels moved with every character. Psi wheels stepped irregularly, governed by the smaller motor wheels. It was a cipher built on controlled chaos. Tutte's deduction gave the British something priceless, a blueprint of their enemy's invisible weapon. But hand calculation could go only so far. Testing thousands of possible wheel settings by pencil would take weeks. Mathematics had reached its human limit. Mechanization had to begin. To multiply Tutte's logic, the engineers of Bletchley built a strange hybrid device, part mechanical, part electronic. They called it Heath Robinson, after the cartoonist famous for absurd contraptions. The machine ran 2 continuous paper tapes side by side. One carried the intercepted cipher, the other a simulated keystream from the theoretical Lorenz wheels. Light beams and photocells compared the two at blinding speed, counting matches, compiling statistics. It worked, sometimes. But the tapes stretched, slipped, and tore. Synchronizing two endless loops proved nearly impossible. One engineer watching the machine had already decided it was the wrong path. Tommy Flowers, an engineer from the post office research station, had worked with electronic switching. He knew valves, hot, fragile, and fast. Where others saw unreliability, he saw potential. Flowers proposed a single tape system driven entirely by electronics. No moving parts, no synchronized reels, just light, current, and calculation. The idea sounded mad. Over 1,500 glowing valves working in unison? They said it would never stay stable. Flowers built it anyway, mostly with spare parts and on his own risk. By December 1943, in the basement at Dollis Hill, his creation flickered to life. They called it Colossus, and the name fit. A wall of valves, logic gates, and rotating paper reels, Colossus could process 5,000 characters each second. For the first time, electricity itself was thinking. On the 18th of January 1944, Colossus Mark I was installed at Bletchley Park. Within days, it was reading live Lorenz traffic, analyzing wheel patterns that no human could trace unaided. It didn't replace the cryptanalysts. It amplified them. Mathematicians still defined the tests. Colossus simply executed them at a speed no person could match. By spring, the results were transforming operations. Messages that once took weeks to decode were now broken in hours. Then came the next leap. By June 1944, Colossus Mark II was running, faster, more precise, nearly five times the throughput. 10 machines would follow. As Allied ships crossed the Channel, Bletchley's electronic giants were already dismantling the enemy's mind, one bit at a time. By the spring of 1944, Bletchley Park was no longer a quiet lab. It was an industrial machine for thought. Signals poured in from Knockholt and Bomenor. Colossus devoured them. Wheel patterns, statistical tests, probabilities, all reduced to electronic motion. Each decoded message was sent to the testery for translation, then to the War Office and Supreme Headquarters. For the first time, intelligence could move faster than the enemy's orders. At the front, the results appeared as miracles of timing. Allied convoys that steered clear of ambush, bombers striking supply lines the moment they opened. The truth was not luck. It was calculation. The Nazis' most secret voice was now a source of information for their enemies. Their cipher had become a window. Inside the Reich, confidence remained absolute. To the Oberkommando der Wehrmacht, their Lorenz machines were mathematical fortresses. Security was assumed, not tested. Only a handful of German cryptologists even knew of Lorenz. Those who did believed interception was impossible. Their true weakness was hubris, a faith that complexity alone creates safety. When minor anomalies appeared in field traffic, no alarm was raised. No one imagined an enemy machine could reconstruct their code in minutes. By the summer of 1944, the Germans were still speaking in clear to their enemies' ears. The miracle of Colossus was not just its speed, it was its people. Tutte's mathematics gave it purpose. Newman's vision gave it structure. Flowers' engineering gave it life. He had risked his own money and reputation to build it. No funding was offered, no orders signed. He simply believed it could work. When the first message printed out, clear German text from what had been noise, the operators fell silent. They had witnessed the moment a machine did what once required a roomful of geniuses. It was still the humans who guided it, who decided what to ask. But the machine was answering faster than they could think. The work of Colossus remained hidden behind the veil of ultra-secrecy. Only a few commanders knew its name. The data it produced fed directly into Allied operations, verifying that Hitler had swallowed the bait of Operation Fortitude, believing the real invasion would strike Pas-de-Calais. When the armies landed in Normandy, Colossus was already reading German orders from the day before. Intelligence had outrun warfare. For the first time, strategy was guided not by intuition, but by data. By the war's end, 10 Colossi were running day and night. They processed millions of characters, turning the enemy's confidence into confession. When Germany fell, few knew how it had already been defeated, in circuits, long before in combat. When victory came, Colossus was dismantled and classified. The world moved on, unaware that the future had already begun in a wooden hut. 8 machines were destroyed. 2 survived in silence inside GCHQ, serving in secret until the 1950s. Then they too were taken apart. For decades, credit vanished into official secrecy. Only later did historians reveal the truth, that the world's first programmable electronic computer was built not for profit, but for peace. In those valves and wires lay the blueprint of every digital system to follow. Each pulse of current inside Colossus was a bit, an idea, the beginning of the world we now live in. The Nazis dismissed electronic brains as fantasy. They believed machines could never think, yet their defeat was signed by one. Colossus was not born to kill, it was born to understand. It transformed intelligence into calculation, and calculation into knowledge. In that moment, the age of war machines became something else, the age of thinking machines.